Hey class, this video recording is for this week's topic, which is module 9 about titrimetry. And just to give you a heads up, this module will actually be somehow really hard. Medyo mahirap yung topic po na ito, so it's better to focus on the information that will be provided and aralin maigi. And to be honest with you, during face-to-face classes, if you will be performing titrimetry, this will require accuracy and precision at isa to sa isa sa pinakamahirap na experiments here in ANACHEM. Ha, makinig po maigi, mag-take down notes ng maigi, intindihin ang information, this topic will be hard. Okay, so first, let's try to look at this picture in our left side. This is the picture of the setup ng titrimetry. Okay, then titrations are widely used in ANACHEM to determine the concentration of the acids, bases, oxidants, reductants, metal ions, proteins, and many other species. So, here, in analytical chemistry, titrations will be used to determine unknown concentrations of these kinds of substances. Example siguro, kapag nagkaroon ng mga chemical spills, and gustong malaman gano'ng kataas yung concentration ng mga materials na contaminants, we can use titrimetry for that. And titrations are based on a reaction between the analyte, which is the unknown, or hindi natin alam yung concentration, yun po yung analyte, and a standard reagent known as the titrant, which is of known chemical or concentration. Okay, and then the reaction is of known and reproducible stoichiometry. Ang stoichiometry, guys, ito yung parang balancing chemical equation. So, kung kayo during high school, nagkaroon kayo ng topic under chemistry regarding balancing chemical equation, yung mahirap, yun po yung stoichiometry. So, in this basis sa titrimetry, yun yung binibase natin na kapag pala balance ang isang chemical equation, malalaman natin yung concentration niya. Is it, ang sabi nga dito, known and reproducible stoichiometry. So parang given na na kapag ang isang substance or ang chemical equation ng mga substances na pinaghalo-halo is balanced, yun yung basis ng titration. Okay? The volume or the mass of the titrant needed to react completely with the analyte is determined and used to calculate the quantity of the analyte. Yun nga kasi yung unknown natin, yung concentration ni analyte. But si titrant, alam natin yan. Given yan. Kapag gagawa kayo ng experiment, alam natin yung concentration ni titrant. Okay? So again, another introduction to titrimetry, a technique for determining the concentration of a solution by measuring the volume of one solution needed to completely react with another solution using nga po yung given stoichiometry. Titration process involves addition of solution of known concentration, which is the standard, from burette to the measured volume of the analyte, which is of unknown concentration. And here is the general principle of our titrimetry. It is based on the complete chemical reaction between the analyte and the reagent or the titrant of known concentration. So yun nga, kapag balance ang chemical equation ng ating reagent at analyte, doon natin malalaman na ito pala yung tamang chemical na gagamitin or dami ng chemical na gagamitin para ma-reach natin yung parang balance nila. Okay, then ito po, itong picture na to na sa ating right side. Ayan, this is the parang setup at step-by-step procedure na ating titration na pag-uusapan natin maya-maya. Okay, so let's define first some terms para hindi masyadong nakakalito kung ano na yung sinasabi natin. So again, first, what is an analyte? Pag sinabi po natin analyte, it is the solution of unknown concentration. And ha, unknown, ibig sabihin hindi natin alam yung concentration niya. So, in reality, sa titration, ito po yung hinahanap natin. Kaya nga tayo magta-titrate to know this concentration of the analyte. But ang ating analyte has unknown volume. Oh, baka medyo nalito. Ma'am, ano po yung ibig sabihin the solution of unknown concentration but known volume? Here in this beaker, Okay, so for example, ito po ang ating analyte. Kunwari, itong nasa loob ng beaker na to. Ang kanyang concentration po is yung laman niya mismo, which is, again, sabihin na lang natin na this is sugar. So yung concentration, pag hinalo mo po yung sugar here, yun po yung concentration niya, yung pinakalaman niya. So, here in a titration, hinahanap natin yung concentration ng sugar na nandito po sa beaker at yung known volume, ito po, yung volume ng tubig is alam natin, which is, ayan nga nakalagay sa beaker, is 150 ml. Ang aalamin natin ngayon is gaano karami ngayon yung sugar. Okay, so yun po yung analyte. So again, an analyte is the solution of unknown concentration, which is, for example, is your sugar, but known volume. Known volume kasi kita naman natin dito kung ano yung volume ng water, which is 150 ml. Yan po ha, yan po ang ibig sabihin ng ating analyte. Si analyte yung hinahanap natin. Okay? And we also have the titrant, which is the solution of known concentration naman. Yun yung gagamitin nating basis para kung gaano karaming titrant ang ginamit, dun yung base natin kung gaano karaming analyte. Okay, so we also have your standard solution, a solution of known concentration. So pwede rin ang ating standard solution is our titrant. The types of standard solution, we have si primary standard, which has a certain property na extremely pure, highly stable, and can be weighed easily. Kaya nga po siya primary, so it is recommended to use this. Example po niyan is sodium carbonate. And then, number two is a secondary standard. It has a certain property. It is less pure than your primary standard. It is also less stable and cannot be weighed easily. For example, is your sodium hydroxide and hydrochloric acid. Okay, so here in this illustration, sa ating left side, ang nandito po is the known concentration of your reactant, which can be your standard solution. And then, here in the nasa baba, this is your aqueous solution with unknown solute concentration, which is our analyte. Okay? So, for example, in titrimetry, gusto nating malaman gaano po kataas yung concentration ng hydrochloric acid in our sample. So, we can use a base, which is sodium hydroxide here in the burette, and then papatuluin po natin yan dito sa baba to know the concentration of this using the given stoichiometry nga po. Ayan. So, dapat no, dito sa titrimetry, maalam tayo dun sa balancing chemical equation. But since hindi ko naman na kayo masyadong pahihirapan, hindi naman tayo na magkakaroon ng parang pinaka-topic for that. Ang mahalaga lang ngayon, na alamin natin or alam nyo is kaya po natin nakukuha yung unknown concentration using reactants or known concentration of reactants is because there is a given stoichiometry na, yung balance nga na. Kapag kunwari nag-react yung isang substance sa isang substance, ang products niya is ganito karami. So yun po yung pinaka-basis ng titration. Okay, so we also have here your equivalence point, another definition. Equivalence point is point where the amount of two reactants are just equivalent. At ito po yung makikita natin here in titrimetry, in something like this. Ito po yung parang end point or equivalence point ng ating mga reactants, which is your titrant and your analyte is equal na yung kanilang amounts and it will reach the equivalence point. Ayan, ito po ang equivalence point. Napansin ba? Nag-iba yung color. Ayan, once na nag-iba yung kulay, somehow that is the equivalence point na. So, meaning ng equivalence point again, meaning equivalence, meaning equal na po yung amount ng dalawang reactants na pinagsama natin. In this case, kanina, is sodium hydroxide and your hydrochloric acid. Then, aalamin mo kung gaano karaming sodium hydroxide ang kailangan para mag-iba yung color nito. Okay? And then your endpoint. Endpoint is the point at which the reaction seems to be complete. This point is usually seen with the help of an indicator or color indicator. Just like here in this illustration, Napansin ba, 'di ba, from color parang yellow naging color blue. So it signifies that is the end point of the reaction using the indicator or color indicator. Oh, 'di ba, nag-iba yung kulay, yun po yung end point. Okay, so again, what is an indicator naman, ma'am? It is an auxiliary substance which helps in the usual detection of the completion of titration process at the end point. So, examples po niyan ay mga reagents natin like methyl orange. Ito guys, pinakamadalas ginagamit sa laboratory, yung phenolphthalein. Yung phenolphthalein, yun po yung parang nagiging color pink after the end point. And then we also have crystal red and thymol blue and many others. This is just the most common examples. But again, pinaka-common po na ginagamit sa laboratory. At ang gagamitin na rin natin dito na parang example here in this PowerPoint is phenolphthalein. So, phenolphthalein po, once you use this kind of indicator and you will already reach the equivalent point or end point, you can see parang color pink na pagkakaiba. Okay, since this is a titrimetric calculation, wala naman tayong kailangang imat dito, no? But i-explain ko lang kung bakit ganun yung nangyayari here in titration. Titrimetric calculation is based on the following law of equivalence. So, Na, which is the normality of the analyte. Normality, guys, signifies the concentration po, okay? So, pwede natin sabihin normality is the concentration of the analyte. Then, you also have here your Va, or the volume of the analyte, is equals to the concentration of your standard solution and the concentration or volume of the standard solution. Okay, so again, I repeat. Titrimetric calculation is based on the law of equivalence. Kasi nga, di ba, ano bang tinitingnan dito kay titration? Di ba, yung equivalence point or yung end point nila kung saan there is an equal concentration of your analyte and your titrant or standard solution. So here, it is represented by this equation, which is NaVa is equals to NsVs. So concentration of the analyte and the volume of the analyte is equals to the, ayan, Ns, normality of your standard solution and yung volume of the standard solution. So example dito, this is a balanced chemical equation. Ito yung nangyari dito kanina. Ayan. Yung NaOH plus hydrochloric acid. So, ito po yung nangyari. So, HCl plus NaOH. Then, ganito equals yung product niya is H2O plus sodium chloride, which is a salt. Kasi di ba pang naghalo tayo ng acid at base, isa sa mga products niyan is salt. And then, nagkakaroon din po ng water. And if you can see, this is a balanced chemical equation. Ma'am, paano po natin nalalaman na balanced ang isang chemical equation? I-review ko lang konti. Isa-isahin nyo yung ating mga elements, which is yung hydrogen, di ba? Tapos si Cl is chloride. If you will look at how many atoms of HCl or hydrogen and chloride in the other side of the equation, dapat po equal sila. So, katulad nito, here in this equation, dito lang muna tayo tumingin. Ito lang. Yung HCl plus NaOH. Kasi ito yung part ng, isang part ng chemical equation. Then, ito po yung products niya. Okay, so here. So, hydrogen, letter H. Ilang hydrogen po ang meron dito? Dito, from here to here. Diba, dalawa. Isa, tapos dalawa. So, dalawang hydrogen. O, sige, tingnan natin doon sa kabilang side ng chemical equation. Hydrogen, ito pong hydrogen, dalawa. Okay, so if that's the case, okay tayo kay hydrogen. Equal sila kasi dito po dalawa, which is ito, tsaka ito. At dito sa kabilang side ng equation, meron ding dalawang hydrogen. So, equals po sila. Next, si chloride, si Cl. Okay, so dito sa side nito, ilan ang chloride dyan? Isa lang. Ito lang. What about in the other side of the equation? Ito lang po. isa lang. So if that's the case, parehas isa lang ang chloride. Okay, balance po ang mga chloride ions natin next. Sodium, yung Na. Here, isa lang. Dito sa kabila, isa lang. Okay, so if that's the case, sodium ions are also balanced. Last one, oxygen. Isa. Pagdating dito sa kabila, isa rin po ang ion ng ating oxygen. So, yun, na-check na natin lahat ng ating mga elements dyan, which is your hydrogen, chloride, sodium, and oxygen, all of the ions of from one side of the equation to the other side of the equation is equals. Thus, this chemical equation is balanced. At yun po again ang basis ng ating titrimetric calculation is against the law of equivalence, which is the normality or the concentration of your analyte and the volume of the analyte is equals to the normality of the standard solution and the volume of the standard solution. Okay, so next slide that you're seeing right now, here is the apparatus used or needed for titration. Ganito po yung setup niya kanina, di ba? You need your burette, you need a stand, you need a measuring cylinder or graduated cylinder. White paper, guys, it's important po kasi kailangan natin ng white background para makita natin po yung change of color agad-agad. Kasi kung medyo dark yung color ng ating parang stand, madalas kasi guys parang color silver or dark silver yung dark gray, sorry. Dark gray yung ating mga stand na ginagamit sa laboratory. So, baka kasi hindi agad makita yung change of color kasi yun po yung tinitingnan talaga dito here in titration. So, kapag hindi nakita, mamimiss niya po yung equivalent point, okay, or end point. So, mali na experiment, uulit yon. So, it is a must that you will use white paper or white background here para makita po natin agad yung change of color. And you will also use conical flask or Erlenmeyer flask. You will use an indicator such as phenolphthalein. At kanina, di ba, marami tayong example. Ito lang yung pinaka-common. You will use some kind of basic solution in the burette or vice versa. Pwede naman guys, ha? Pwede to. Pwede po naman dito is a base, dito naman yung asido. So, pwede pong ganun. And you also be needing, of course, is a pipette para ma-i-transfer nyo yung mga liquids natin here in the setup. Okay, so ito na po yung pinaka-steps ni titration. Makinig po tayong maigi. This can be very confusing, especially hindi natin siya na-demonstrate ng actual. Okay, number one. Typical setup for carrying out a titration. So, the apparatus, ganito nga po yung tama. Ganito yung itsura dapat nung setup na gagawin natin. The apparatus consists of a burette. Ito po yung burette, guys. It contains graduations or parang measurement, parang ruler, ganun. Kasi kailangan alam natin, no? Ito yung isa sa pinaka-importante. Eh. Alam natin yung ganong karaming fluid po yung nandito sa loob ng ating burette. Kasi yun yung magiging basis natin kung gano'ng karami yung concentration ng isang sample. Okay, so you also be needing a burette stand. Ito nga po yung stand natin. And yung clamp, kailangan din po ng clamp, ayan, para tagahawak yung burette. And a white porcelain base to provide an appropriate background for viewing indicator changes. Yun nga, di ba, yung katulad kanina, ito po, yung white paper. So, kailangan po yan para makita agad yung color change. Kasi yun yung pinaka-indicator eh. Kaya nga tayo gumagamit ng color indicator. So, dapat kita agad kapag nag-iba ang kulay. And then, a wide mouth Erlenmeyer or conical flask containing a precisely known volume of the solution to be titrated. And the solution is normally delivered into a flask using a pipette. So, kailangan po yan ng pipette. So, again guys ha, maging familiar po sa ating typical setup ng ating titration. Ganito po yan. Ito po yung mga different apparatus used at dapat ganito po yung itsura niya. Okay, so okay, tapos na tayo sa setup. Next thing that you should do is the detail of the burette graduations. Normally, the burette is filled with the titrant solution through within 1 or 2 ml of the zero position at the top. The initial volume of the burette is read the closest 0.01 ml or always 2 decimal places. Okay, so next thing that you should do, since na-setup na natin, di ba kanina, may setup na tayo. Ilalagay na natin ngayon yung ating titrant. Ano nga ulit yung titrant? Di ba yung titrant is the solution or standard solution of known concentration. So, known ha, alam natin yung concentration at volume niyan. Okay, so you will use a beaker and then here is your funnel. Ayan. Hindi ko sure kung nakikita siya sa cellphone. Pero yan po. Nakikita naman siya guys, naka-cellphone ako ngayon actually. Nakikita ko siya ngayon. Okay, so ito po. Here is your funnel. Lalagay mo yung funnel dyan doon sa taas ng ating burette at maglagay ka kunwari ng titrant solution mo dyan. At dapat po, yung titrant solution should reach the, here, doon sa pinaka-zero position po. Ayan. Ayan, o, di ba? May graduations kasi yan, guys. Eh. So, dapat po, ang ating titrant should reach the zero level. What if, ma'am, sumobra po ng onte yung ating titrant solution inside the burette? What you can do is you will open. Ito po. I-open niya yan. Para yan, gripo, guys. Pag in-open niya yan, lalabas po yung ating solution sa loob ng burette. At ayun na, hanggang sa ma-reach niya po yung zero. Ay, kasi dito, in this case, here in this illustration, nung naglagay ka kunwari ng titrant, sumobra. Ayan o, ito po yung zero. Tapos sumobra siya. Eh, dapat is leveled dun sa zero. So, what you will do para po bumaba sa zero yung ating solution sa loob, you will open the burette. Parang gripo po yan. Lalabas dito sa baba yung ating solution that inside the burette hanggang sa ma-reach na po yung zero. Once you reach the zero, i-close nyo na po. Kasi kung hindi niyo i-close yan, guys, tuloy-tuloy lang lalabas yung solution sa loob. Okay, and the initial volume of the burette is read to the nearest 0.01 ml. So here, guys, in titration, para clear tayo at pare-parehas tayo ng magiging sagot, the initial volume or any readings in the burette should be 2 decimal places lagi. Kahit, ano, kahit saktong 0, for example, to. So, nari lang, saktong 0. Dapat 0.00. Kasi po, very accurate po ang reading dapat ng ating titration because even just a drop, na mamali kayo ng lang labas ng drop, mali na po yung ating concentration agad. So, dapat very, very accurate at precise ang ating mga measurements here. Okay, so dapat po, again, 2 decimal places. Okay. So, ayan po. Maglagay tayo ng titra. Okay. So, next step. O, diba, nakapag-set up na tayo. Nalagyan nyo na po ng solution yung burette natin of known concentration or standard solution na lang. Sige, para malinaw. Third step. Before the titration begins, the solution to be titrated, for example, an acid, is placed in a flask. And the indicator is added as shown in this photo. The indicator in this case is we will be using phenolphthalein, which turns pink in basic solution. Okay, so here is your sample of unknown concentration but known volume. Okay, so hindi natin alam yung concentration ni acid eh. Kaya nga natin siya itatitrate para malaman natin. But alam natin yung volume na gagamitin natin, which is 20 ml of acid. You will add this in your Erlenmeyer flask using a pipette. Then after you add your acid, you will now put few drops of the acid-base indicator. In this case, we will be using phenolphthalein, which again turns pink in basic solution. So, since this is an acid, acid yung ginagamit natin, right? Once you put your indicator, walang mangyayari pong pag-iba ng color niyan. Kasi again, phenolphthalein only turns pink in basic solution. Again, guys, phenolphthalein only turns pink in basic solution. But in this case, since acido po yung gagamitin nating sample, once you put your indicator here, hindi pa po yan agad-agad magbabago ng kulay. Kasi acid nga yan eh. So if you put a few drops of the acid-base indicator here in this step, dun lang sa acido, wala pa po kayong makikita ang color change dyan. So colorless pa rin siya. Okay, so sige, balikan natin from the start. Okay, nakapag-set up ka na ng ating titration. Nalagyan na natin ng basic solution or standard solution yung ating burette. Nalagyan mo na ngayon ng sample na asido plus ng indicator yung iyong flask. Next step naman natin is the titration itself. Makinig po maigi. The titrant is added to the flask with swirling until the color of the indicator persists. So, what does that mean, ma'am? Diba nakapag-setup na tayo? Ito na, kunwari, nandito na yung iyong standard solution or yung titrant mo, which is a base. Sample sodium hydroxide. Dito sa baba, diba naglagay ka ng acid plus indicator? O-open mo na ngayon, guys, yung burette. Ito po, ayan yung kamay o. Tas, para kasi yung gripo, so pag tinurn mo yan, parang pinihit mo, lalabas na po yung solution sa loob, which is base. Okay, and then the initial region of titration, titrant may be added rapidly, so pwedeng mabilis dun sa unang part ng ating titration, so pwedeng mabilis. But as the endpoint is approached, increasingly smaller portions are added at the endpoint. Less than half of the drop of the titrant should cause the indicator to change color. Okay. So, sa unang part daw po, kapag bukas mo ng ating burette, then lalabas yung fluid dyan, right? Ayan o, katulad nito. Lumalabas yung fluid dyan. So, habang lumalabas po yung fluid, sa unang part, pwedeng mabilis po yung tulo ng ating solution sa loob. But as you reach your end point, dahan-dahan na po dapat yung pagbukas. Actually, ang preferably dito, kapag nakikita mong malapit ka na dun sa end point, is drop by drop na po yung dapat nilalabas nyo here. Okay. So, ayan po. Again, ito po ang ginawa. Ito yung kamay. Ayan, di ba? May parang gripo nga yan eh. So, pipihitin nyo yan. So, lalabas sa loob yung ating sample solution or yung inyong standard solution. Paglabas nyan, so, of course, lalabas dito sa ating flask. And as you can see, nung lumabas po yung fluid inside the burette, unti-unti pong nag-iba yung kulay nito. Also here, this is unknown concentration of hydrochloric acid. So, meron tumutulo dyan na standard solution, which is a base. Maya-maya lang, nagiging pink na siya. But do take note here, guys. Here in titration, sabi dito, solutions turn pink but when swirled goes colorless. Isa sa mga pinakamagandang technique kasi para makita nyo po talaga yung parang color change is iswirl nyo po yung ating flask while the sample or standard solution is being drawn to this. Okay? Ayan, isa-swirl nyo po siya, parang iikutin nyo. Ayan, katulad nung ginagawa dito sa parang mga videos. Ayan, di ba? Iniikot-ikot nila. So, sometimes kasi, makakakita na kayo ng color change habang nagpapatakpo kayo dyan ng inyong titrant or yung standard solution nyo. However, here in this case, yan, solution turns pink but when swirled goes colorless. So, ibig sabihin, kapag po naging colorless pa after swirling yung ating, yan, yung unknown concentration solution natin, hindi pa po yun yung endpoint. Okay? You will reach the endpoint. The endpoint is achieved when the barely perceptible pink color of phenolphthalein persists or hindi na po nagbago. Kasi in this case, ayan, balik tayo dito. So if you can notice, ayan, sabi daw, solution turns pink but when swirled goes colorless. So, kasi dapat sinuswirl po yan, iniikot yan habang lumalabas yung fluid here. However, if you can notice na there is a slight change of pink color, but once you swirl the flask or the Erlenmeyer flask, bumabalik po siya sa pagiging colorless. If that's the case na after swirling the solution, it turns colorless again, hindi nyo pa po nare-reach yung end point. Kasi nga ang sabi dito, the end point is achieved when the barely perceptible pink color of the phenolphthalein persists or hindi na po sila nagbago. Just like here. So, kunwari na last drop ng swinurl, naging pink na siya, o di ba? Hindi nagbago or nagbalik sa colorless po yung color niya. Okay, the flask on the left shows the titration less than half of a drop prior to the end point. Ito po yan. The middle flask shows the end point. Ito po. Diba? Perceptible pink lang guys ha. Hindi po dapat dark pink. Because once you reach the dark pink color of the indicator, it means you actually exceeded the end point. So, if that's the case, nakakita kayo ng dark pink dun sa inyong experiment, uulitin nyo po sa simula yung lahat ng ginawa nyo. So, again, recall natin. Ayan po, this is a good endpoint. Perceptible pink lang, onting-onting pink lang guys. Because once you reach this kind of color, which is a dark pink, that is overly titrated or maling endpoint na yun po. Sumobra kayo. So, ulit ka sa simula. So, dapat perceptible pink lang at dapat nag-persist or hindi nagbago. Because there is a tendency na makakita po kayo again ng ganitong color. Meron kayo nakitang pink, however, upon swirling, naging colorless siya ulit. So, hindi pa yan tapos. So, you will add additional standard solution. And once you reach the color perceptible pink or light pink and it persists, that's the end point. But if sumobra kayo ng lagay ng ating standard solution, you will reach this kind of color at uulitin nyo po yung experiment. Okay. And then last one. Okay, so di ba naka-reach na kayo ng end point. O kunwari ito na yung itsura ng ating titration. Ganyan. Ganito po dapat, light pink. The final reading of the burette is made at the end point and the volume of the base delivered in the titration is calculated from the difference between the initial reading and the final burette readings. Note, you need to make a rough estimation first, then do 2 to 3 accurate titrations, and then the difference of the accurate titration should be, ayan, should be averaged. Meron na wala dito. Iaayusin ko na lang sa PowerPoint natin yan. Okay, so again, ito na yung end point nyo. Babasahin natin ngayon ulit yung burette. Okay, so ang parang pinaka-volume delivered, so kung gaano karami yung inyong nailagay dun sa ating burette or yung dun sa ating sample solution, yun po yung parang ibibase natin dito. So again, kunwari for example, your initial reading in the burette, so in trial 1 is 10.95. Ito na lang pala. Ayan. Sige. So, here, kunwari, ito po yung setup ni titration nyo. So, naglabas ka ng ano dyan, ng standard solution dyan. Okay. So, you will first, di ba kanina, you will read the initial reading, which is, in this case, I think is 8.60. Di ba? Here is 8. Tapos, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So, in this case, this is 8.60 cubic centimeter. So, that is your initial reading. At after the initial reading, di ba, you will now titrate this. So, bubuksan nyo na yung gripo ng ating burette hanggang sa makareach kayo ng color pink. And after that, you will now read the final reading in the burette. So, kapag ganon, titignan nyo ulit yung burette at babasahin nyo siya. So, example, your initial reading was 10.95. So, bago tayo nagsimula, di ba, nag-read tayo ng burette. And then, after titration, ang reading mo na ngayon doon sa burette is 27.85. The next thing that you should do is you will now minus the final reading minus the initial reading, and you will now get the volume added in the sample, which is 16.90 in this case. Okay, so again guys, ha, ulitin ko. Diba nagbasa tayo ng buret kanina? Initial reading was 10.95, for example. Then, after titration, your final reading now was 27.85. Next thing that you should do, once you read the final reading, minus mo na yung final reading, minus initial reading, which is 27.85 minus 10.95 is 16.90. This is now the volume added to the sample or the analyte. Okay, so yan po, 16.90. However, you need to make first a rough estimation, which is your trial. So, here in titration or titrimetry, you will actually do 3 to 4 titrations in one sample. So, that is the ideal, which is, again, yung first trial nyo is rough estimation lang siya. Yun nga yung sinasabi kanina na pwedeng mabilis yung tulo ng tubig or nung ating standard solution. And then next is you will then do 2 to 3 accurate titrations. So in this case, dalawa lang yung ginawa. And then the difference of the accurate titration should be measured. So, ayun, initial reading. For example, dun sa accurate titration mo, yung dahan-dahan mo nang ginawa. 10.18, then final reading mo is 27.95. Then you will subtract these two, you will get 17.15. And then your next second or accurate titration, initial reading was 9.50. And then final reading mo was 26.65. You will minus these two, you also got 17.50. And the average volume added, you will use the accurate titrations, guys, to average the volume added. And then since pareha sila, average mo ngayon is 17.50. So, this is the volume added to the unknown concentration of the analyte so that you can reach the equilibrium. Okay. So, sige. Ulitin lang natin para malinaw talaga. You will set up your experiment. Ganito ang itsura ng setup. Next, you put the standard solution or your titrant inside the burette using a funnel. And then you will now read the initial volume of the burette and always read in the nearest 0.01 ml or always 2 decimal places. So even if sakto siya, dun kunwari sa graduation na 5, that should be 5.00. Always add 00 at the end if kulang. So, basta dapat 2 decimal places. Okay? So, yan. Naglagay na tayo ng standard solution here. Next is before the titration begins, use a Erlenmeyer flask. Input your sample of unknown concentration but of known volume, which is in this case, 20 ml daw po ng asido. And you will add a few drops or 2 to 3 drops of your color indicator. We will be using phenolphthalein in this case. This is the commonly used. Phenolphthalein turns pink in a basic solution. That's why when you put the drop of indicator phenolphthalein here in the acid, it will not change color because, again, this is an acid. And phenolphthalein only turns pink in a basic solution. So then during titration, the titrant is added to the flask with the swirling until the color of the indicator persists. There can be a case wherein makakakita kayo ng change of pink color in the unknown concentration of the analyte. However, if it turns colorless again after swirling, it's not the end point still. So hindi pa siya end point. Kaya yan po, ganyan. And then after swirling, you will now end once you reach the end point is achieved when the barely perceptible pink color of phenolphthalein persists, meaning kaya siya nag-change ng pink kasi naging basic na po yung solution nyo. Kasi di ba nag-add tayo ng base here, kaya siya naging pink eh. So, dapat perceptible pink or light pink lang po yung color. The flask on the left shows the titration. Less than half of a drop prior to the end point. So, ganyan. And then the middle flask here is the end point. So, light pink color. However, if you reached a dark pink color, it means you exceeded the end point or equivalence point. So, here is a good end point, light pink. Once you reach this color, that is overly titrated and you need to redo the experiment. Okay, so after you reach the end point, you will now read the burette again for final reading. Final reading, ayan po. The volume delivered should be calculated using this formula, which is initial reading. Baliktad to, sorry. Final reading dapat to. Final reading. Sorry, sorry. Okay, so again, volume delivered is calculated using this formula. Final reading minus initial reading is equal to the volume delivered. And then note, you need to make an estimation first, which is your trial experiment, and then do 2 to 3 accurate titrations. And then the difference of the accurate titration should be calculated and averaged. So, yan po. So, here, example lang to, example picture. This is the initial reading, kunwari, which is 8.60. And then, bubuksan nyo po yung burette and then babasahin nyo yung burette once you reach the end point. Input the final reading. The title here is the volume delivered added. Okay, so if you want to check out how titration is being performed talaga, like actual experiment, you may click this link. It will redirect you into a YouTube video wherein they perform titration and actually explain some information regarding this. And so guys, panoorin nyo siya. I actually inputted this also in the Google Classroom. So it's a must that you watch this so that you can see how titration is actually being performed. So, mas maiintindihan nyo guys yung pinagsasabi ko dun kanina dun sa step-by-step procedure if you actually watch this video. Medyo mahirap kasi siyang i-imagine, di ba? Medyo magulo. So, kung naguguluhan kayo dun sa pagkaka-explain kanina, you may watch this video para mas clear sa inyo how titration is actually being performed. Also, we also have here a simulation for practice. So you click this link. It's up to you if you want this or not, but it will redirect you in this kind of setup. Click quick start. You can try to click titration level 1. And yeah. So here is a simulation of the titration experiment. So if you want na kayo mismo po yung gagawa ng titration, I suggest you do this simulation. Tingnan nyo ha. Yan. Meron kayong mga sasagutan dyan. So dapat panonoorin nyo yung mga videos. And then, ayan po. At merong simulation po dito nung ating titration. So, this is very good for practice, lalo na for retention ng step-by-step procedure. So, I highly suggest that you do this simulation po. But it's up to you if you want it or not. Okay, so last one, I think this is the very last one regarding titration, is the different types of titration. So, yung ginawa po natin kanina is actually a type of acid-based titration, which is also called neutralization. We also have another type, which is complexometric. We also have redox titration and precipitation titration. Let's just try to discuss what are the difference of these four. So, again, yung kanina ginawa natin is the acid-based titration, which is neutralization as well. Neutralization kasi, di ba, once you added the acid and the base, magiging neutral. So, a sample of unknown concentration of acid is estimated with a known concentration of base or vice versa. So, pwede pong baliktad. Yung ginawa kasi natin kanina, unknown acid tapos known base. But pwede rin naman pong baliktad yung gagawin natin. Okay? So here is the chemical equation why an acidless base, then it will equals to salt. These are the visual indicators used for acid-base titrations. Ang ginamit nga natin kanina, di ba, is phenolphthalein, wherein in low pH color, it is colorless. So kung acidic po yung pH, colorless. But if you will be doing a high pH color, it will turn red or yung parang pink nga po. Then here is the experimental color change or range. So 8.3 to 10.0. So you can use different kinds of indicator. Hindi lang po yung phenolphthalein na pink. Meron pa po dyan yung color blue, color violet. Yan. Color yellow, meron din po. It really varies depending on what titration na gusto nyo. And then you will choose an indicator for that. It really varies, no, kung ano yung gagamitin nyo. You should also take note of the experimental color range. Yan. So, kung anong pH nagre-react yung mga titrans nyo at yung analytes na ginamit, yun yung magiging basis nyo kung ano pong indicator ang gagamitin nyo. But tayo kanina nga, ang ginamit natin is phenolphthalein, wherein in low pH color or the acidic, colorless po siya. And in a high pH color, that is color red or color pink. At ito nga po yung range niya, 8.3 to 10.0. Nung gumamit tayo ng phenolphthalein, na ba naging color pink or red? Here is the different applications of acid-base titrations in reality. So, ito po. You can use this in food and petroleum industries, constant monitoring of acids and bases in both reaction mixtures and finished products is a common requirement which titrimetric methods frequently fulfill. So, hindi kasi masyado dapat acidic or basic yung mga foods, di ba? Katulad nito, this is milk. So, parang tinetest natin yan for yung ating mga manufacturer, tinetest yan for acidity or basicity using titration po. Also, petroleum, pwede din. Probably the most well-known example of acid-base titration is your Kell-Lull method. Paki-take note, meron pong star dito. The recall question is, makinig, Kell-Lull method for nitrogen determination in organic compounds like protein. Ma'am, ano po ibig sabihin yan? Ang ating proteins kasi guys, ang kanyang chemical structure is composed of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. Using the Kell-Lull method for protein determination, ang dinedetermine po ni Kell-Lull is the amount of nitrogen present in that protein. I repeat, Kell-Lull method for protein determination determines the amount of nitrogen in the sample. So, Kell-Lull method employs actually acid-base titrations in one of its principles. So, paki-take note po again ang recall question natin here. Kell-Lull under acid-base titration is based on the nitrogen determination in organic compounds like protein because protein is actually composed of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. Wherein in the Kell-Lull method, ang dinedetermine po nga natin is the concentration of the nitrogen in the sample. Okay, another type of titration, we have si complex symmetric. As the name indicates, the endpoint is seems by formation of complex molecule. Di ba? Very simple. Complexometric, yun na yung keyword yun na lang, complex molecule. And also take note here, ang isa sa parang special sa kanya is the use of EDTA or EDTA. And here is the application of EDTA titration. So, yun na lang tandaan natin kay complexometric titration. Merong formation ng complex molecule at merong EDTA. And then, sabi pa nga dito, once complex is formed, the complex is stable and not further reaction takes place. Unlike kay acid-base titrations, di ba? Kasi pag sumobra tayo dito ng mga phenolphthalein or sumobra tayo dito ng reaction or drop ng ating standard solution,
may reaction pa din. Unlike here in complexometry, no further reaction takes place and the complex is stable na po. Okay, another type of our titration is redox titration. Redox titration, as the name suggests, is based on the oxidation reduction between analyte and the titran. Here is the oxidation and reduction. Oxidation po, ito siya, is characterized by, ito po, pag-gain ng protons at ang ating, or loss of electrons na lang, sige. Oxidation is based on the loss of electrons. Electrons po, di ba, is negatively charged. That's why kapag reduction, wherein there is a gain of electron, as you can see, from a charge of neutral, naging negative. Kasi nag-gain po siya ng electron, which is a negatively charged particle. So, yan po yung basis ng ating redox titration. Again, redox is oxidation reduction between the analyte and the titran, represented by this equation. And then, the endpoint of a redox titration may be observed by following the potential of the titrant with an indicator, electrode, or a visual indicator or color indicator. So, kanina kasi, yung mga pinag-uusapan natin, we can detect the endpoint there using a visual indicator wherein, yun nga yung mga phenolphthalein, mga cresol red, mga ganon. Here in a redox titration, we can actually use an electrode. Ma'am, why? Why here kailangan or pwede tayo mag-use ng electrode? Electrode, guys, is parang dinedetect niya kasi po yung charged particles. Wherein, ito po yung case natin in redox titration is the charge of the particles wherein, di ba, naging positive or negatively charged. So, in this case, we can use an electrode to indicate the endpoint. Unlike in the previous types of our titration, we can only use a visual indicator or color indicator. So dito pwede tayong gumamit ng electrode kasi nga ang concern natin in a redox titration is the oxidation and reduction of our analyte and titrant represented by charges like positive or negative. Okay, and then I think this is the last type of our titration. We have precipitation. Precipitation are based on the formation of insoluble precipitates or yung parang buo-buo po na maliliit when the solution of two reacting substances are brought in contact with each other, it is called precipitation titration. The principle here is quantity of the added precipitating agent or the precipitant is equal to the substance being precipitated. So, equals daw sila. So, basis pa rin naman dito is yung law of equivalence. So, equal daw po yung amount ng precipitating reagent dun sa substance na pre-precipitate natin. So, if you can notice here in the illustrations, di ba parang malabo siya. Ibig sabihin may mga precipitants yan, guys. Buo-buo. Unlike here, di ba ito yung una, parang clear. Tapos maya-maya, naging parang malabo. And that is due to the presence of precipitants. Example nga po doon is once you added silver, which is aqueous or liquid in nature, plus chloride, which is also aqueous, once you added this two, you will come up with a product which is silver chloride na solid. Yung S ibig sabihin solid or precipitate. Diba? Pag pinagsama, parehas liquid. Tapos, ang ending niya, magkakaroon ng solid formation or precipitate. So, ganito po yung nangyayari. So, ayan. Yun nga po, ang concern natin here kay precipitation titration is the precipitation formation. Ganun lang. Example, silver nitrate plus sodium chloride is equals to silver chloride plus sodium nitrate. Then we also have mga different types of precipitation titration. We have first is the Moore method. Ayan po. We use here chromate as an indicator. Yung CrO4 po, that is a chromate. And we also have the Wohlhard method wherein you will use a standard SCN or thiocyanate. We also have the Fajans method. You can use here fluorescein and its derivatives are adsorbed into the surface of colloidal silver chloride. After chloride is used, the first drop of silver will react with the fluorescein forming a reddish color. So, para lang malinaw. Okay, more, ginagamit po natin is chromate. Okay. Si Volhard po, we will be using thiocyanate or yung SCN na tinatawag. Here in Fagen's method, meron pong presence ng fluorescein forming a reddish color. Among these methods, the Volhard method is widely used because we can detect the endpoint of precipitation titration very well. So out of these three, si Moore, si Volhard, tsaka si Fagen's, widely used po yung Volhard kasi kaya daw mag-detect na endpoint precipitation ng maganda. And here is the indicators that you can use in precipitation titration. We have potassium chromate and silver chromate. Then here is the summary na lang ng ating discussion. So here is the principle, di ba, inisa-isa naman na natin. Here is the apparatus used. Applications, kung saan ba ginagamit yung ating titration talaga. And of course, the disadvantages of this method is storage of large volumes of solutions is used, instability of some reagent solution, and need for scrupulously clean glassware. Kasi nga, di ba, kahit isang drop, mamali ka ng isang drop ng patak dun sa ating sample solution, mamamali ka na po dun sa ating experiment. That's why clean glassware should be used. Very, very clean glassware. So, dapat walang kahit isang patak ng tubig once na ginamit.